don't want to make everybody stand up with three dogs. We don't need that. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the Vermont Veterans Home All Faith Memorial Chapel. We are going to hopefully share with you a little bit about four individuals, four chaplains, who gave their lives for many others in saving their lives. And we're going to kick right off. I lost my paper already. I'm going to ask Dee to come up and lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance, if you will.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. And now I'm going to ask Mr. Please sit down. Please sit. I'm going to ask Mr. Fred Dunn to come up and do some introductions.
Welcome to VBH, our chapel of the four chaplains. I'm Fred Dunn, a trustee here at VBH, and I'd like to welcome all the American Legion members and members of other veterans organizations here. We have other trustees here, the president of the trustees back there, Sir Krosick, Colonel Krosick. We also have the leading candidate for national commander for the American Legion here, Denise Rowan. Welcome, Denise. We have other leaders among us too, too numerous to mention. Many from our own chapter, post 13 here in Bennington. Like many veterans, I have a chaplain story. Back in November of 1972, I went to the chaplain's office in Fort Monmouth, New Jersey, with my wife and three children. I was an E4 specialist for working at Fort Monmouth. And we're a little low on cash. We had a lot of rent. We lived out in the economy in Asbury Park. We had to pay rent, utilities, and we didn't have a lot of money for food. And the chaplain there, a full colonel, loaded up a box of groceries for us and insisted on carrying it out to my car. I mean, I was impressed. Insisted on carrying it out to the car. I said, "Son, open the trunk up." That's my chaplain story. I really appreciated that thoughtfulness. We're here to commemorate the four Army chaplains, all first lieutenants, that passed away on that ship that fateful night. The four of them are George L. Fox, a minister of the Methodist Church; Alexander D. Good, a rabbi of Reformed Judaism; Clark V. Poling, Reformed Church in America minister; and John P. Washington, a Catholic priest. Interesting aside here on George L. Fox. He was the oldest of the group. He'd been born in 1900 and served in World War I. He lied about his age. This was before he was a minister. He lied about his age. And got into the anyway, he's basically a medic at 17. He received, while he was in Europe in France, medical corps assistant, it was called. He was awarded the Silver Star, Purple Heart, and the Croix de Guerre from the French government for his bravery in battle. He also was born in Pennsylvania but married a Vermont woman and was a minister in the Methodist Church in Union Village here up in Thetford, Vermont. He also was the state chaplain and historian for the American Legion of Vermont. So there's something to think about. I'm sure it's going to be stated later, but let me tell you a little bit about what happened that night. This was February 3rd, 1943. The United States Army Transport Dorchester, which is a converted, was a converted cruise ship, was torpedoed by U-223 off of Newfoundland. Now you got to remember, this is the North Atlantic in February. Water temperature about 34 degrees. And the ship went down in a half an hour. Unfortunately, when it was hit by a torpedo way below the waterline, all the electricity was knocked out including the radios in the ship. They were with a small convoy of three ships escorted by three Coast Guard cutters. One of the cutters spotted the explosion and came over. But by the time they effected rescue, two of the Coast Guard cutters came over to try and save as many of the men as they could. One of them stayed with the rest of the convoy. They could only recover 230 of the men on board out of 902. A lot of the bodies were recovered because they were still in life jackets, but they died from hypothermia. The chaplains that we're talking about today calmed everyone down on the ship that they could, assisted them in getting off the ship, handing out life jackets. They also gave up their own life jackets. And witnesses did see them at near the rail, holding up arm in arm as the ship went down. Carl Sandburg, a famous author, once said, "Valor is a gift. Those having it never know for sure whether they have it until the test comes." The four chaplains had the gift of valor. Thank you.
Thank you, Fred. Now I'm going to ask Don Tatro to come up just for a couple minutes for a couple more introductions.
Yes. Good morning.
Good morning.
We have some notables in the audience from the American Legion. One of them is our State Commander John Heald from Polney. Our NEC man, National Executive Committee man from Groton, Vermont, Frank Pallet. Sitting behind Frank is our alternate NEC lady. She's from St. Albans. The guy with the white hat and the camera there is our local historian for the Department of Vermont, Ray St. John from Montpelier. We also have our legislature representative, Mary Morrissey, sitting in the back, who is always at one of our functions if she can make it. Thanks, Mary. Y'all know who I am, so I won't introduce myself. Thank you.
Thank you, Don. And now, if you all would uncover. Let us pray. Gracious God, we ask your blessing upon this Four Chaplains Interfaith Memorial Service. We have come to this sanctuary to worship and share in remembrance of these four outstanding chaplains, Catholics, Jews, and Protestants. We come together in this holy place of the Lord to worship, to praise your name, to thank you for your constant presence in our lives. We come together to honor four men who had gone to war as chaplains, to be the human torch of your love and caring among troops called upon to risk their lives for their country. We honor four chaplains who knew how to live and love their neighbors as themselves. We are thankful for the lessons they gave to the generations, lessons of self-sacrifice and true brotherhood, With thankfulness, we ask your blessing upon the souls of Chaplains Fox, Good, Poling, and Washington. May all who are present at this service again gain wisdom and compassion from worshiping together this day. In your holy name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
And now let me introduce Dee Holtby.
Can you hear me? Now?
Yes.
It was known as Torpedo Junction, the U-boat infested icy waters of the North Atlantic during World War II. On February 3, 1943, the USAT Dorchester, an old coastal steamer, quickly pressed into military service, was slowly making her way through those waters bound for Greenland. Most of the men were seasick and green with nausea. Because they were in submarine waters, the captain directed the men to keep outer gear and life jackets on at all times. Moving among them were four Army chaplains, George Fox, Alexander Good, Clark Poling, and John Washington. The chaplains talked with and listened to the men, soothing apprehensions, offering encouragement, or sharing a joke. By their concern, their camaraderie with the men and one another, their very presence, they brought solace. An enemy submarine stalking the ship undetected fired a torpedo toward the ship's aging flank. The missile exploded in the boiler room, destroying the electric supply and releasing suffocating clouds of steam and ammonia gas. Many on board died instantly. Some were trapped below deck. Others, jolted from their bunks, groped and stumbled their way to the decks of the stricken vessel. Taking on water rapidly, the ship began listing to starboard. Because security reasons prevented the use of distress flares, escort vessels, still close enough to assist, pushed on into the darkness, unaware that the Dorchester was sinking. Overcrowded lifeboats capsized. Rafts drifted away before anyone could reach them. Men clung to the rails, frozen with fear. Unable to let go and plunge into the dark, churning water far below. The four chaplains calmed frightened men, got them into spare life jackets, and urged them over the side. The supply of extra jackets ran out with men still waiting. Having decided to remain with the sinking ship, the four chaplains either gave to or forced upon frightened servicemen their own life jackets. Too quickly, no more lifeboats could be launched, and many men were left aboard. But there was more for the chaplains to do. When last seen, they were standing together on the deck, leading the men in prayer. With arms linked in friendship and heads bowed in prayer, they sank beneath the waves. Two of those chaplains were Protestant, one was a Catholic, and one was a Jew. Monsignor John McNamara, the former chief of chaplains of the U.S. Navy, said at a four chaplains award service, "No casting director in Hollywood could have selected a better cast of characters than those four to portray the basic unity of the American people. The self-sacrifice of the four chaplains was a heroic act. It was not the only heroic act aboard the Dorchester, but it was the identity of these four young men representing three great faiths of the American people that adds symbolism to their sacrifice. It is our charge to see that this brief but significant portion of American history is not lost, and that the lessons of cooperation and selfless service are proclaimed."
Thank you, Dee.
I'm going to do a collect, but before I do that, we're going to light our candles to remind us of God's presence here today. God's presence and God's light in the world. have a very short collect. God of our fathers and our God, we thank you for the unity that the Dorchester Chaplains, these four men of God, demonstrated in life and in death. Unity that is not uniformity. Unity that strengthens within each of us every worthy loyalty of faith and practice. Unity that transcends all our differences and makes us one in loyalty to our country and our fellow men. And to you, our God. Grant us now your abiding presence, and may we remain faithful to the spirit of our four chaplains, who, having learned to live and serve together, in death were not divided. And now we're going to have a special musical selection by Mr. Fred Stebbin. Fred, you're on.
If you know these, please join with me, because I think everybody knows the Star Spangled Banner.
We know this story is one of many examples of true brotherhood. Yet we single out and hold it before us as a reminder that all persons of all faiths and colors and creeds are capable of showing such courage and such compassion. Such has been true of so many who have served in all branches of service in times of war and peace. Such has been true throughout the generations. In the case of the Dorchester, more than 600 men saw the end of their hopes and dreams on that icy morning of 3 February 1943. In the effort to sustain the hopes and dreams of their families at home, may they rest in peace. Amen. And another musical selection.
You can stay sitting this time, but it'll be America Beautiful, so please join.
Thank you.
tribute to the four chaplains.
I light this candle in memory of Alexander D. Good. Alexander D. Good was both an outstanding athlete and scholar. Following in his father's footsteps, this young man, known for his laughter and love of life, became a rabbi. While studying for his calling, he joined the National Guard and kept up an active membership. The return of the body of the unknown soldier had a profound effect on Good. He attended the ceremonies, choosing to walk the 30 miles rather than drive or take a bus, because he thought it showed more respect. Good married his childhood sweetheart and was serving as a synagogue in New York, Pennsylvania when World War II broke out. He served on active duty from August 9th, 1942 until February 3rd, 1943.
This candle in honor of Captain George L. Fox. George L. Fox, the oldest of the four, knew all about war. Lying about his age in 1917, he enlisted in the Army as a medical corps assistant. He won a Silver Star for rescuing a wounded soldier from a battlefield filled with poison gas. The Croix de Guerre was for outstanding bravery in a military barrage, and the Purple Heart for wounds. A resident of Vermont, he was a successful accountant and family man when he heard God's call to the ministry. Fox went back to school and later was ordained in the Methodist denomination. When war came, he once again enlisted, telling his wife, "I've got to go. I know from experience what our boys are about to face. They need me." Fox began active duty on August 8, 1942, and served until that fateful morning of February 3, 1943.
I light this candle in memory of John P. Washington. John P. Washington grew up poor, scrappy, and determined in the toughest section of Newark, New Jersey. One of nine children born to an Irish immigrant family, he was blessed with a sunny disposition, a beautiful singing voice, and a love for music. He also loved a good fight and was leader of the South 12th Street Gang when he was called into the priesthood. He played ball with the boys of the parish, organized sports teams, and when war came along, went with his boys into the Army. He began active duty on May 9, 1942. His wonderful voice, raised in song and prayer to comfort those around him, could be heard until his final moments on February 3, 1943.
Light this candle in the memory of Clark V. Poland. Clark V. Poling was the youngest of the four chaplains and the seventh generation in his family to obtain the Dutch, ordained in the Dutch Reformed Church. When war came, he was anxious to go, but not as a chaplain. I'm not going to hide behind the church in some safe office out of the firing line, he told his father. The elder Poling replied, "Don't you know that chaplains have the highest mortality rate of all? As a chaplain, you'll have the best chance in the world to be killed. You can't carry a gun to kill anyone yourself." So Clark Poling left his pastorate in Schenectady, New York, and enlisted as a chaplain. Just before he left for active duty, Clark asked his father to pray for him. "Not for my safe return, that wouldn't be fair. Just pray that I shall do my duty and have the strength, courage, and understanding of men. Just pray that I shall be adequate." Poling began active duty on June 10, 1942, and served until February 3, 1943.
And now, if you'd all join in a final musical selection, I know everybody knows it. God Bless America. Stand or pass. Please sit.
If we could just have a couple of moments of silence, please. Thank you. Thank you.
I want to take just a moment to say thank you to just two or three folks. Dee, come up here, would you, Noah? When we started talking about doing something together from Post 13 and 69 up in Arlington, it was Dee's idea that we ought to do a joint celebration or memorial for the four chaplains. Dee, I want to thank you so much for sharing in this ceremony. Thank you. And I want to thank Fred Stebbins over here for traveling about 100 miles with his equipment, to do a little music selections for us. Thank you so much, Fred. Thank you for the four individuals who have represented the four chaplains. There are two ceremonies that we do in the American Legion that just touch my heart. One is the POW MIA ceremony and the four chaplain ceremony. Thank you everyone for coming and sharing with us in remembrance of four very courageous individuals, the four chaplains. I am so thankful to God that I can even be called a chaplain. I hope I have just a fraction of the courage that they showed that night on 3 February 1943. And with that, let us pray. Precious Lord God, stretch forth, we pray, your almighty arm to strengthen and protect the military of our country. Support them in the day of battle and in the time of rest and training. Keep them safe from all evil. Endue them with courage and loyalty, and grant that in all things they may serve without reproach. Now as we leave this holy place, may the Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance on you and give you peace. Amen.
Amen.
God bless everyone. Thank you so much for coming. This ends the ceremony.